Hello everyone, I, Harshita Srivastav, co-head private equity and M&A practice at NDA, along with Sach Chhabria, who's a member of the corporate practice here. We are here today to discuss one of the key announcements of the budget, which was presented by our finance minister, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, for the financial year 24-25 on July 23rd, 2024. This was the first budget of the newly elected government, and as indicated in the interim budget, which was announced earlier this year, the government continues to stay on the path of fiscal consolidation and economic stability. Amidst other changes which were introduced by the government, one major announcement that was made was regarding the abolition of angel tax. And given the general sentiment and the resistance of the stakeholders against angel tax over the course of the last few years, including from a constitutional perspective, this was a big move and will be very well received. Over to Sach to understand what is angel tax. Sach, if you could just explain to the audience in terms of what was the infamous angel tax all about.
Sure, Harshita. So the angel tax was actually introduced in the Finance Act 2012, and it was under Section 56(2)(7B) of the Income Tax Act, and was originally introduced with the intent to discourage shell companies and prevent circulation of black money. Angel tax is basically a tax which is applicable on companies where the public is not substantially interested on the receipt of consideration for issuance of shares in excess of the fair market value of the shares of the company. The excess consideration that is received by such Indian companies is taxable as income from other sources. However, till March 31, 2023, this was limited to investments received from residents of India. But the Finance Act of 2023 expanded the applicability to non-resident investors as well. There are certain exceptions where angel tax provisions are not applicable, where the consideration of for issuance of shares is received by either a venture capital undertaking from a venture capital fund or a Category 1 or 2 AIF who is registered with SEBI or which is regulated under the International Financial Services Centres Authority Act, or a company or a class of person which is notified by the central government on this behalf. This notification includes certain entities such as government and government-related investors, which you should note will include sovereign wealth funds as well. It also includes banks or entities involved in insurance business, where an entity is applicable is subject to applicable regulations in their home jurisdiction. Further, certain entities who are residents of 21 notified countries will be exempted. These notified countries include USA and UK, but notably it excludes jurisdictions such as Singapore, Mauritius and Netherlands. The Central Board of Direct Taxes went on to further notify that angel tax provisions are not applicable in cases where consideration for issuance of shares is received by a startup recognized by the DPIIT, if these startups fulfill certain conditions. Over to Harshita. Harshita, I wanted to ask, what are the issues being faced by companies at large on account of this angel tax?
Sure. So I think such an interesting point here, that it was, you know, if you see how the startup industry generally works, it was very common for foreign investors to invest through a, you know, convertible instrument, preferably a CCPS, which is a compulsorily convertible preference share. Now, foreign exchange control laws in India require the conversion formula of the CCPS to be determined upfront at the time of issuance, and also provide that the price at the time of conversion should not be lower than the fair market value which was determined at the time of issuance of the CCPS. Now, from a private equity and venture capital deal perspective, investment in CCPS is the most commonly resorted to. And also because there is often a gap between how a, you know, founder perceives the valuation of the company and how the investor perceives the valuation of the company, right? Now, to bridge this gap, investors often invested at a little delta or a price which was higher than the fair market value, and with balancing rights such as anti-dilution, liquidation preferences, etc. Now, what happened in case of a down round or an exit was that an investor would exercise its anti-dilution right or a liquid pref right, resulting in the conversion of the CCPS at a price which could be lower than the investment price, but always higher than the fair market value at the time of investment. Now, the levy of angel tax was creating issues in terms of negotiating some of these rights, particularly at the time of fundraising by the Indian companies. and thereby making the investment in the Indian companies less attractive and also creating a lot of structuring, you know, issues for foreign investors in particular. The tax on capital, you know, besides this issue of, you know, of the foreign investors investing at a price which was higher than the fair market value. Besides this, the tax on capital was also viewed as an unreasonable restriction on the right to carry on business, which is guaranteed under Article 19(1)(g) of the Constitution of India. It appears to have breached the constitutional tenets by excessive delegation and arbitrary exercise of authority by the income tax authorities, where they could potentially replace share valuations arrived at through commercial negotiations. As a result of all of this, cumulatively, several prominent startups received tax notices on the valuation of shares of the startups in different rounds, right? And that sort of regulatory uncertainty led to foreign investors looking at other jurisdictions when it came to investing, and obviously also stifled the growth of new ideas and innovations in India. If you look at historically the statistics, a lot of startups actually moved or domiciled themselves in alternate jurisdictions like Singapore, Cayman Islands, or US, obviously for a multitude of reasons, but one of the reasons also being the uncertainty around the levy of angel tax in India. But you know, such an interesting point here is given that the angel tax now stands abolished by the budget, it would be interesting to note and see, and you know, how this abolition of tax is likely to impact the industry.
Sure, Harshita. So adding on to your point, which is really interesting about them shifting their domicile to other jurisdictions, if you look at the figures, amidst other factors, you can attribute the introduction and expansion of the ambit of angel tax to lead to the startup funding drying up in 2023. If you compare the figures in 2022, which was around $41 billion, it has, the funding for startup has dried in 2023 to around $11.3 billion. So this move of abolishing angel tax, which happened in the budget, was heavily appreciated by investors and the Indian startup ecosystem at large. So startups, how it's impacted startups is they now have the opportunity to make larger bets and take more risks because they are facing reduced funding constraints. The sectors that actually would predict the most in this instance would be sectors which are extremely capital intensive. So, for example, you have deep tech, AI and green energy, which are going to most likely see a rise. In terms of investors, it could definitely boost the confidence of both domestic and international angel investors when they invest in Indian startups, especially when you look at the other changes which have been proposed in the budget, which include a reduction in long-term capital gains on unlisted securities from 20 to 12.5%. as well as simplification of the rules which pertain to FDI. And the budget also introduced certain measures to facilitate the ease of doing business. Hence, you can see that this policy change in India would lead to more regulatory certainty, which would in turn attract FDI. And this is a move which is going to bring India at par with global best practices. Thank you all for listening.